No, we can't see the notes. We can't see the notes. It's just the screen.
Okay.
The presenter.
Yeah, because I have two screens and I don't know which one it shows. Can you see my laser pointer as
yes.
well?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's...
Okay, so when you're ready, when you want me to start, just let me know. I can just to tell I cannot see you guys because of the two screens disappeared somewhere, but I'm here. So if you have questions, just shout because I'm not going to see you.
Okay, no problem.
Okay.
So I think I'll start with the housekeeping.
Yeah? Okay.
All right. Welcome everyone. Welcome to today's talk by Dr. Vihar from University of Glasgow. So before we invite the MC as well as Dr. Vihar to the stage, I'd like to provide a 5 minutes welcoming speech by the Director of Center of Printable Electronics, Prof. Nohayati. So the stage is yours, Prof. If you want,
thank you, Dr. Sharifa. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh, and very good afternoon for those who are in Malaysia. Okay, and good morning to Dr. Vihar. So just a very short welcoming remark. Thank you very much, Dr. Vihar, for accepting the invitation. Right, so we are really very pleased to have you in this session. To know about the latest improvement in the tools, right? Okay, yep. So I also welcome all the participants in joining to me it is for those who are in device simulation or in device modeling, it would be a very valuable session. Okay, welcome to all. Okay, thank you. Okay, Dr. Sharifa.
Thank you, Prof. Okay, for everyone who's here, to the participants, please make sure that your microphone is muted. And if you have a question, please write your questions in the chat box, or you can keep it until the end of the session and we'll read it out for you. Okay, without much ado, I'd like to invite Dr. Razaidi as the MC for today. So Dr. Razaidi, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Sharifa. Okay, hi, Vihar. So before we start, with your presentation, I would like to, read your biography first, so that everyone know what's your expertise. Okay, so Dr. Vihar Petrov Georgiev received his bachelor and master degree in chemistry and computational chemistry from Sofia University, Bulgaria in 2004 and 2006, correspondingly. And then after that, he received a PhD degree from the University of Oxford in 2011. In 2011, he joined the Device Modeling Group, School of Engineering, University of Glasgow, where he was a research associate until August 2015. From August 2015 until August 2019, he was a lecturer, and currently he is a senior lecturer in electronic and nanoscale engineering and the deputy leader of the device modeling group in the School of Engineering, University of Glasgow. Also, currently he is a quantum simulation and business development advisor at SemiWise. Okay, for today, Dr. Vihar will give a talk about simulation of ultra-scale electronic device with a novel flexible Nano TCAD Nano-Electronic simulation software NESS environment. So without further ado, I would like to invite Vihar to give his speech. Okay, Vihar, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I have a just quick question. For most of the people here are master degree or PhD in electrical engineering. Is this what it's correct? Well, I just want to know the background of the audience to know how I should talk. Is this Razaidi correct? Are they master students or PhD students?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Okay, so I hope you can see my screen now, the notes.
Nice.
Yes, okay. So thank you very much for the invitation, and thank you for the opportunity to invite me to give a talk here. And as you can see here, this Glasgow and very sunny day, it's happening quite not so rare, but it's from, let's say, 50% of the time, and this is part of the university. And as you can see here, and as any know this, that were somewhere based here in the University of Glasgow. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to give you a flavor about the simulations that we're trying to do in Glasgow and the research that we're trying to develop. And I'll start with introduction, like a brief introduction for the university and the group, literally two or three slides. I'm going to tell you about our new software, which we call it NESS, Nano-Electronic Simulation Software, that we're developing in the moment. And I'm going to go step by step to show you some of the modules of this software. And I'm going to give you examples which are linked with some of these models. And of course, I'll finish with some conclusions. So my aim is to finish for around 45, 50 minutes. And after this, we can have 10 minutes for discussions. Sorry, guys, someone is knocking. I'll be back. Just a second. Daniel, I kept a presentation. Okay. See you later. Sorry, guys. So let's go further. What we have here is University of Glasgow, the different divisions. And you can see there aerospace, biomedical, electrical, and nanoscale, infrastructure and environment, and power. And we, device modeling group, we are in this part, electronics and nanoscale engineering, and we have three teams inside: electronics, photonics, and quantum and nano. And we, as a device modeling group, are in this region, which is called quantum and nano. And as you can see here, is my name here, and Professor Asen Asenov, which is RZID's PhD supervisor, who has been doing simulations in device modeling group in the last 30 years, even more. So I came here as a postdoc, as RZID said. And after this, I became lecturer, and now I'm senior lecturer, and we work together with Professor Asenov in the area of device modeling and simulations. So what is our main idea is to support research in semiconductor devices, like making 3-5 or silicon nano devices, and we work with Glasgow and some of the guys here, Ross. But also now, if you want to know, we can talk about this later. We're moving to the quantum simulations, and we have projects linked to cryosimals and qubits a bit, and we have working with these people here with Martin and Scaves and so someone else. So if you're interested about the University of Glasgow, you can go and look on this website or ask me, and you most probably will find people that they do something very interesting for you, because at the moment the university is growing quite a lot, and we'll be around 200 people in the school quite soon. Now we're around 130, 140. Okay, device modeling group. You can see pictures from the current people, and you can see Professor Asenov, me, and some of the postdocs. We have 6-7 postdocs, and we have 6-7 PhD students. The people here on the bottom are guys which are not with us anymore, but they came 4-5 years ago when we started developing NESS. And the reason that I put their picture here is that because this was the initial team that started developing NESS, and now they left. Salim works in Intel in United States. Hamilton works in a company simulating solar cells in Zurich. And these two guys work here in Synopsys in Glasgow. We have very good connections with the Synopsys company here in Glasgow. Around 15-20 people from our group works there. And RZID knows this as well. And in Glasgow, what we have also in our group, we simulate devices, mainly based on statistical variability. We use different methods like Monte Carlo or quantum transport. I'm going to talk about this a bit. RZID had PhD in reliability, and this is what we've been doing also. We have projects, actually one project just starting now for $1.5 million, about molecular electronics and making molecular or probing the states of molecular molecules using CMOS technology. We have process simulation, circuit simulation, and compact model simulation. So this is more or less the research that is going on in Glasgow about different devices. Okay, so I'm not going to waste more time. I'm going to move further. I'm not going to convince you, but most of you, I'm sure, are aware that we live in silicon age or silicon technology, and what you see here is the transistors. And what you see is that in the last 20 years, the transistor moved from planar architecture to something which is kind of 3D dimensional. I'm sure you know this, and this is FinFET. And nowadays, people are talking, Samsung or TSMC are talking about gate-all-around transistor or nanosheets. And if you go and read and you go and buy a phone like this, they will tell you that Samsung made it a 2-nanometer node of nanosheets, and this is the current state of the art, which is true. So this is the evolution of the transistors. This is the evolution of the transistors in the last 20 years. And why you want to make the transistors smaller and smaller and smaller? Because you have better performance, larger integration, lower power consumption, and lower cost. And to do this, you need to overcome a lot of problems, scientific and engineering problems, and they're linked mainly to something which is called short channel effects, mobility reductors, leakage current, degradation, ion-NF ratio, and variability issues. I'm not going to go in details for all of this, but each next technology node that you try to create, you need to overcome some kind of significant engineering challenges linked to some of these points that I mentioned here. Why you want to do simulations? And I'm sure I don't need to convince you much. You need to do simulations because they save time and money. For the industry, this is extremely important because saving time and money means more profit. And from point of view of industry, it's important to also understand the device physics. So the TCAD simulations can help you the device understanding the device physics, optimize your device, help you to solve some fabrication problems, and analyze some statistical data, for example, and help you this design technological optimization process as well. The commercial TCAD that you most probably use in Synopsys or Silvaco, I would imagine, in Malaysia, they are very nice, mature software. They can do a lot of things, but it's very hard to implement new stuff inside. So it's very hard to implement models from kind of beginning if you want to do this. So what we want to do with NESS and our software, we start writing this open TCAD simulation software, open source. We're trying to make it open source really next year at some point. And what we want is people to be able to plug different modules to our solvers and do some interesting research. We believe that this will open a lot of possibilities for new collaboration. So I'm here and I'm happy to discuss with you options to collaborate in the future if you want. And the other thing that we think is really important, and I know from company's perspective is really important, is to educate the people in the right way. What I mean in the right way is not only to know the physics, but also to have these technical skills of programming, debugging, you know, software management or project management in order to be able to contribute and work well in the company. Can you hear me, guys? Because I cannot see you in general.
Yes, we are okay.
Okay, good. So our simulator, or all of the simulators that you can imagine, they have kind of different approaches, and you try to implement different numerical recipes to solve specific equations. And usually in our world, we treat the problems, especially when you simulate transistors or current flow, in kind of three different ways. You have something which is called classical drift diffusion approach. It's literally solving drift and diffusion equation from chemistry together, and you add some mobility models to simulate the current flow in the device. And this has been working in the last 50, 60 years very successfully, and people really like it. And this approach is relatively fast, but cannot capture all of the physics which is required nowadays to simulate ultra-scale nano devices. On the other end of the spectrum is so-called quantum description approaches, where you treat the electrons or the holes as waves, and this allows you opportunity to kind of have entanglement and calculate tunneling probabilities, and this is what I'm going to show you, some examples. And the other is, this is much more challenging in terms of time. And the other is semi-classical approach, which is called Monte Carlo or Kubo Green node, which is between these two approaches and can give you, for example, mobility in a sense of different scattering events or scattering probabilities disentangled. So I'm mainly going to talk about quantum descriptions first, but I want to show you first the overview of NESS. As I said, NESS is nano-electronic simulation software. It has MPI or OpenMPI, and it's open-ended simulation environment. We try to add it to make it for everyone useful. And this paper we published this year, and is the latest kind of development in NESS. So if you want, you can go and have a look. And what we have in NESS and mainly is something which is called structure generator, that you need to create your structure. I'm going to show you what I mean by this. We have effective mass extractor, which we need in order to extract the effective masses if it's required for our Green's function, because the Green's function module here works with an effective mass approximation. We have a database that we have all of the required parameters for the material, by quirk function affinity, the electric constant, and all of this is sent to our solvers that I'm going to go step by step through each of these boxes and give you literally one slide, a flavor, why we have these boxes or these different solvers, which all of them are linked to 3D Poisson equation and also to Schrodinger equation. And now we have six band K.P module. And of course, everything comes out as part of your text file that you can manipulate and visualize. Okay, so structure generator is the most important, the first module that you need to learn in order to make your structure. Once you make your structure, you don't need to touch it. You just generate a file that the NESS software can read it. But what we can create is we can create nanowires, we can create stack nanowires, we can have elliptical or square nanowires, we can create bulk MOSFET, and we can introduce different sources of variability like random dopants, metal gate granularity, or lineage roughness. So all of these sources of variability comes from the fact when you fabricate the device, now in this very small dimension of the device, so nanoscale dimensions, two devices not identical, and this creates problem. And the variability comes from the fact of the dopants, how they are distributed in the source and the drain, and the metal gate granularity, for example, and they can be implemented in a different way in the software. And we've been doing in the last 30 years, maybe Professor Asenov, many simulations of this statistical variability on the device performance. And as I said, we can have random dopant distribution, lineage roughness, and metal gate granularity. I'm not going to go in details how we implemented this. You can go and see this paper, and you can know more about the different methods, how they are implemented. The other module that we have is effective mass extractor. And what you have here is we can calculate the band structure, or the band structure must be calculated with first principle methods, for example, DFT, for, let's say, square, circular, and elliptical nanowire. They will have a different band structure because of the quantum confinement and the different shape. And what you see here is DFT simulation or cut in the middle of the device here for a nanowire simulated with quantum ATK software. And this is so-called first principle method, atomistic simulations. And in this case, it's calculated with a time binding model. And the band structure, and more specifically, this is the conduction band, it's shown here with red lines. The black circles here corresponds to our effective mass extractor, which fits the data to these red lines. And why is important for this? For us, it's important to be able to extract this delta y, delta z, and delta x, which are the band curvature of the lowest subband, which we need for our Green's function solver. Once we extract this for specific cross section, we can keep it in our database and we can do the simulations. As I said, you can go and look in this paper for more details, but this is how is the main idea between this effective mass extractor. What you can see is that they match very well in the lower subband, not so well in the higher subband, but this is not a problem because the current or the transport is mainly dominated by the lower subbands here. And if you go further, when you have your structure, you have your effective masses on your materials, everything together, you go further and you can put this everything in the solvers. And the first solver that you have is drip diffusion. And as I said, the people have been using drip diffusion in the last 50 years. It works very well, but it requires some tweaking. So this is mainly done through mobility models, and you need to have different mobility models to capture different physics. At the moment, we have constant mobility models, we can have dopant dependence mobility through Mazzetti model, we have electrical field dependence mobility, Yamaguchi, Wognitude, Cauchy-Thomas, and all of this is linked with Poisson current continuity coequation, and this is linked in the loop that we can calculate current. Also, we can use the drift diffusion solution, initial one, as an input to our Poisson negative solver, which I'll show you in a second. Now, the drift diffusion works very well, but when you have quantum confinement, so you have a nanowire, I hope you can see my pen. So if you have a nanowire and looks like this, is this pen, what you need to know is that when you solve the current in this direction, along the direction of the pen, of the nanowire, the quantum confinement is perpendicular to the transport. And because of this, the charges are distributed in slightly different way than the normal distribution. And in order to capture this distribution of charges in the slices, which are perpendicular to the transport, you need to have either density gradient correction and or solving Schrodinger equation in the cross section of the along the transport direction of this nanowire. So we have both. This is much slower but much more accurate, and you can solve density gradient or calibrate the density gradient to the Poisson Schrodinger in order to give you the right charge distribution in the cross section of the device. So this is what needs to be done in order to make drift diffusion works properly for small devices. You need to be able at least to capture the quantum correction along the transport direction of the nanowire in the cross-section dimension. However, it's not always good enough because we need somehow to take into account the electrons actually can tunnel and travel with different speed and have different scattering events. One way to do this is to have this Kubo-Greenwood formalism. And the Kubo-Greenwood formalism is very good because it gives you total mobility, but it allows you to disentangle different sources of scattering events. And this is important, especially now when you talk about CryoMOS, CMOS devices or room temperature devices, you have different scattering events which dominate the transport. And we, at the moment, we have acoustic phonon, optical phonons, and surface resonance scattering. We are trying to implement ionized impurity and a wall scattering. For example, ionized impurity scattering is much more dominated for qubits, for CryoMOS, CryoCMOS, than acoustic and optical phonon scattering. So if we want to simulate qubits, for example, we need to be sure that we have this implemented and this is the main source of scattering events, but we can talk about this later. So you can see more, Christina is the main developer for this. You can see some of her papers talking about this Kubo-Greenwood formalism and Monte Carlo in general. And the next thing that we're developing and something that might be interesting for you is a kinetic Monte Carlo module. So the kinetic Monte Carlo module allows you to calculate, for example, tunneling current through the gate to calculate reliability. So this is kind of trap-assisted tunneling, or can allow you to simulate something which is called resistive memory. And I'll give you an example. I have an example. So you can create ion vacancies, and you can follow the trajectory of these vacancies, like ions and electrons and holes through the oxide, for example. I'll show you. And in this kinetic Monte Carlo is something that we're developing at the moment when you have the kinetic Monte Carlo model linked to Poisson or to the heat equation, and you can have everything in a loop. This started by Tufik and always took over, and also we have this paper published about this kinetic Monte Carlo, and especially molecular-based simulations or molecular flash-based simulations using kinetic Monte Carlo. The main working horse for NESS is this Green's function, and we started developing NESS like 4 or 5 years ago because we had 3 European projects that we needed to develop a Green's function solver to solve current transport in nanowires. And with Hamilton and Salim and Jay Huli and Menk and the other guys and Christina, we started developing NESS, and we started with the Green's function. Our Green's function solver is based on effective mass approximation, and Hamilton implemented 6-band K.P model. We have something which is called self-consistent Born approximation, which is a way to include scattering because it's not always good enough to have ballistic transport. We need to have scattering. I'll show you. It's MPI paralyzed. You can have Ryan source of variability coming from the structure generator. Also, we can have 2D devices, basically what we can simulate, not 2D material, but we can simulate FDSOI, for example, 3D device, but one of the dimensions is periodic. So we can have transport in 2D. And our non-equilibrium Green's function solver is linked to Flinner model, which allows you to calculate band-to-band tunneling. And this is what I want to go now more to tell you about the Green's function capabilities, because I think this is kind of the most mature and more interesting thing, most interesting thing at the moment from scientific point of view. So what Hamilton did before he left, he implemented so-called band-to-band tunneling using Flinner model. And what you have there is you solve Green's function for electrons and Green's function for the holes separately, and you put together in Poisson, and you use this Flinner-like envelope model equation to calculate the band-to-band tunneling in specific devices. And I'm going to give you an example. So you know what's a transistor. You know that the ultimate limit of the subthreshold slope of the transistor is around 60 millivolts per decade. If you can make this 60 millivolts per decade steeper or a smaller number, you have a low power device, much better performing or much more faster performing device. a device which is a potential user or potential candidate for this is something which is called TFET, tunneling field effect transistor. In order to capture the right physics, the only way to do this is to use Green's function. You cannot use drip diffusion. Maybe you can use Monte Carlo with kind, if you kind of modified the code to have tunneling. But what is the main physics that you need to capture is the tunneling from the valence to the conduction band of the electrons. And here we have a device. We have silicon part, which is blue. You have a gate, and this part is intrinsic. And you have a 3-5, which is indium arsenide, which is red. And we want to see, can we simulate this device with NESS? And indeed, we can. If you take the device and you introduce random dopants here, for example, because we know that you have different dopants depending on the doping concentration or different position of the dopants. In gray lines here, you will see around, I think there were around 50 devices in this case with different positions of the random dopants here in the red region. So each line, the gray one, corresponds to one simulation of one device where you have different number of dopants and positions in this red region. The black line here corresponds to so-called smooth device where you don't have any source of variability, so everything is perfect. And what you have here is the median, which is the red, and the green is the mean. And as you can see, there is a huge variation of the on current, of the off current, around two or three orders of magnitude. And if you have current criteria here, you have a voltage threshold, which is around from minus 0.4 volts to probably minus 0.1 volts. So you have huge distribution of the main figures of merit, like ion, IOF, and sub-threshold swap. And how we can understand this? We can understand this from the point of view of current spectrum. So if you look in the simulations, this can becomes really clear. It's much more harder when you have the experiments to try to explain this. So what you have here is device, current spectrum without any random dopant. So the perfect, you have the valence band, you have the conduction band. Here on this side is a silicon. Here on this side is indium arsenide, the 3-5. And what you see here is that when the bands are very close, there is much more current going through and the current spectrum is much more yellow. And when the bands become farther apart, the current spectrum or kind of the current probability decreases. So you have one channel around this which dominates the transport. Now, if I have a device where you have five dopants, I'm not saying where they are exactly in the volume, but what is happening, the main thing is this band is more or less the same, just slightly modified, but this conduction band is significantly different profile, has different profile compared to this band. I hope you can see. And because it's much more parallel to the valence band, there's much more tunneling on the different energies scale. And you can see that now you have more, you open more windows for or more pathways or bridges for these electrons to tunnel from the silicon to indium arsenide part. And you can see the current spectrum is around two times more. This is 0.4, this is 0.008. So having dopants in this part of the device changes the current definitely. And this can be understood with the current spectrum. And if you go further, you can have a device when you have three dopants and these three devices have different current. And what you will see here is that again, the tunneling probability or the current spectrum is concentrated close to where the bands are very close. And now these bands are very similar profile like here, and you have a current going through all of this region from minus 1 to 0.5 EV. But again, the value is 0.015 here, for example, and this is 0.4. So I have less current going in this device for these specific conditions. And if I have device with two dopants, the same argument is valid. So the bottom line of this slide is I have a device with different random dopants. Even if I have, so the current is mainly dominated by the number of the dopants, but also is dominated by the position of the dopants. I can have two transistors with the same number of dopants, like three or two, but I can have different current profile and different current characteristics. So this is the main line of these two slides. We took this job further and we look in the same device, but we added metal gate granularity, and this is a collaboration with people from China. Guan was here and was working with Hamilton. And we published recently, so we have the same device here. We have the different work functions in the gate. And as you can see, the current here is also very broad. It's a huge distribution around 6-7 orders of magnitude of the off current. You have a distribution of the VT, which is in this region, and you have distribution of the ion current. And again, you have the smooth device, and you have the medium and the mean. And if you compare this TFET device with the silicon nanowire, so this is a proper normal silicon nanowires with the same dimensions, you have 250 sample in both cases. The grain size is 3 nanometers. Now you can see distribution as well on the on current, on the off current, and the voltage threshold is kind of shifted to the right. And what is good of the simulations, that what I was saying, we can do some statistical analysis. So what we have here, we can look much more closer and examine all of the distributions. And here you have voltage threshold and probability, and you have a TFET device, you have a MOSFET device. And as you can see, the kind of the mean of the TFET device on the 100 millivolt, and this is on the 220 millivolts. So I have lower threshold voltage for this device, which means I will need to have a lower power consumption in order to turn on the device. So this tells me that the TFET is potentially better than the silicon nanowire as a low power device for your phones, for example. It will drain the battery less. However, if you look further, what you will see is that you have figure of merit when you have log 10 of ion current versus voltage threshold. And what means this is, for example, that if this is a straight line in this direction, so with slope on this way, it means that I have a value, if everything is perfectly aligned, I will have a rho equal to 1. It means that there is a perfect correlation between the VT and ion. And if I have minus, it means that they're inversely proportional. So which means that if I VT goes up, ion will go down, which makes sense. And as you can see, rho for both of these TFET and MOSFET is very close, and you can have almost minus 1 in both cases, but the silicon nanowires, the TFET, the MOSFET behaves better, slightly better, because this value is lower than this value. So the perfect value is minus 1, basically. And we're closer to minus 1 on the MOSFET. And now if you go and look figures of merit, here for IOF and VT, again, this looks very beautiful. It's along the same line and everything is aligned. However, for the VT, for the IOF, you have much more distribution of the voltage threshold, which can create problems when you create noise circuit. So it seems that when you compare TFET and MOSFET, at least in these circumstances, it's better device for low power because the voltage threshold is lower, but the IOF current is much more widely distributed, which might create problems when you make your circuit and try to optimize the circuit and the device. Okay, the other thing that we took with NESS, so we said, okay, we can simulate TFETs. Can we do and simulate something which is called resonant tunneling diode, and why we want to do this? Resonant tunneling diodes are very interesting nowadays for two reasons. One is RF application, like communication, 5G, and the other is something which is called quantum fingerprints. So when you buy your phone, and you pay 600, 700 pounds, 1,000 pounds, you don't want to be fake, right? You want to be sure it's the right one. But you can clone these devices quite easily. So what people are trying to do is to put some kind of protection or some kind of indication that this device has been produced at the right place, and it's the ingenious one, and it's not hacked. And what you can do, you can put resonant tunneling diodes because they're very cheap to produce on your circuit, and you can create physical and clonable functions. This is how they're called, using resonant tunneling diodes, for example, and you can measure the current of this specific device, and you can have this in a database. And after this, if you sell the device, the client can go to the database and compare the characteristics and can know if it's produced on the right place. So Cisco has very similar database, for example. If you buy a product from Cisco, you can open the database, you can compare the outcome of your device, and you can see if it's really a Cisco device or it's not made somewhere else. Okay, so the resonant tunneling diode has source, a barrier, a quantum well, a barrier, and a drain. And this is the device that we took. We have gallium arsenide, indium, aluminum, gallium arsenide. The reason that we chose this is that we have collaborator in Lancaster that he fabricates these devices, and they're working on this area of physical and clonable functions. This is the schematic diagram. This is the PowerPoint representation coming from our simulator. And you can see the gallium arsenide, Inga, Augas, here, the quantum well, and the drain. And when you run NESS, you create this current. And now the current works a bit funny. It doesn't work on the same way like I showed you before. So what you have here is you have a resonant peak, you have a first valley. This region here is called negative differential resistance. And as you can see, when the current increases, when the voltage increases, actually the current decreases. And this is a typical behavior of a resonant tunneling diode. And how we can understand this, why this is happening? Again, we can look on the current spectrum. I showed you this kind of plots, but now I'm going to walk you through this plot because I think from simulation point of view, it's very informative. What you have here in white is the potential profile of the first subband. So I have here the gallium arsenide. The red part here is this potential barrier because I have difference in the band gaps. And here what you have is the density of states. This red, this colorful plot is the density of states of the quantum well, this part, and these are the density of states, local density of states of the source and the drain. What you have with red is the transmission function. So the transmission function comes from Green's function automatically telling you how easy it is to transmit something from the source to the drain, for example. And if you have peaks here, means that in these specific energies, you have a higher probability of transmitting particles or waves compared to this energy, for example. And if you look here, you're in the first resonant peak. And if you look here, what you'll see that you have two kind of channels of transmitting of current. So this is the current spectrum in the first channel, and this is the current spectrum in the second channel. And the current is mainly dominated by the first channel. And the reason for this is that you can see this local density of states kind of penetrates through the barrier, and it's linked to the local density of states of the quantum well. So they're perfectly aligned and they create a bridge. The same is valid here, and this you have a higher probability of current to transmit, and the transmission spectra has a value which is non-zero. And here you have the same alignment between the local density of states of the source, the quantum well, and you create your bridge, and the electrons can tunnel through the barrier. This cannot be simulated with red diffusion or Monte Carlo, because the electrons over there are not described as waves, and here because the electrons are described as waves, they can tunnel through a barrier. Now, when you move to the first valley here, what you see that this density of states is misaligned with the density of states of the quantum well. So your bridge is broken. So you move from here, now you move to here. You broke the bridge, and what you see, the transmission spectrum disappears, and there is no peak, which means that the current cannot go through this, and there is no sharp peak of the current on this stage, which means you have a drop of the current. So the negative differential resistance region can be understood basically with alignment of the local density of states of the source with the quantum well, and when you move this up and down, either you will have more current or less current when they're aligned or misaligned. And this is what is very beautiful in the simulations in my point of view. You can understand this in very significant details, looking at the specific simulations. Now we took this, and again, we introduced different dopants in the device, and we wanted to see how the current is changing. And this is important because when you fabricate different devices, what you have all the time, even if you try to fabricate identical devices, due to the stochastic nature of the doping or the surface roughness, you're never going to have two identical devices, no matter how hard you try. And this is the quantum fingerprint, the physical and quantum function. So no matter if you fabricate it 100 million times, all the time you will have slightly different current. And all the time you will have slightly voltage value, different value of the peak and in the valley. So if you look the device without random dopants, this is the current profile. If you look, let's say, the device with 10 dopants, it looks significantly different. And this peak is shifted to the left. And if you look here, the device, which is with 4 dopants, it's shifted to this position. And what you can go, I'm not going to go explain in details too much, but I want to show the device one, which has 10 dopants, and these are distributed in the source and the drain in one way. Again, create different profile of the first subband of the potential profile, and gives you different tunneling probability in different places. And as you can see, when they are aligned with the quantum well, there is a tunneling probability higher, and the current goes. And this density of states is much closer, but there is no alignment with the density of states of the quantum well, so the current doesn't penetrate, and the electrons cannot penetrate, so you don't have a probability. But as I said, what you see, you have a different current profile for device with 10 dopants, and you have a different current profile when you have device 3 and 4. You can have 7 dopants, so exactly the same number of doping, but they distribute it in a different way. You have 4 here and 3 here, and here you have 4, 5 here, and 3 here, 2 here in this region, and you have a different, totally different profile of the current. And this you can measure. And you can compare this to a database, for example, and you can know if this device is producing this manufacturer or not. Okay. The other thing that we did, and maybe you want to push further, is this K.P method. And I think it's important because nowadays people talk about qubits a lot. And what Intel does, and lately, they take silicon technology and they want to make silicon spin qubits. And if you go and read, and probably you know, they will make it probably FDSOI or nanowires. And what you need to have a lot of gates along the device. And what we did here, we tried Hamilton implemented this K.P method because you need this method to help to simulate holes. The previous one was for electrons. And what you have here is two gates and a dopant on the side to see if NESS can work and handle it. And indeed, NESS can handle it. And through this work in development, I have students and postdoc working on this, and this was something that will push further. And for example, if you look here, you have gate 2, and let's say it's minus 0.45 volts, and this is this plot or curve. And if you change the gate voltage, you can have this current profile. Now, if you change the constant gate voltage here, let's say to minus 0.1, you can have this current profile. And you can see that you have four orders of magnitude of current depending on the what kind of gate voltage you choose for gate 2. And by doing this, you can measure the output, probably the coherent time or the qubit response time. But what you can do also, you can go further and plot again density states and probability current spectrum and see how these dopants are linked, for example. So these are the potential fingerprints of the dopants inside of the device. So these two guys are the dopants, and you can have the density of states of dopant 1, density of states of dopant 2. And as you can see here, they're kind of linked with the dopant density, with the density of states, which means these two guys are going to talk at these specific voltages. So if you don't want them to talk, maybe you need to move this apart, farther apart, the gates. And so using simulation, you can tell how, on this specific cross-section of the device, how apart needs to be the gates in order the dopants or the qubits not to interact to preserve the qubit state. And again, you can look in the current spectrum, and this is just to show that we have whole phonon interaction, and you have some kind of spilling of the current when it goes from the source to the dopants to the drain. Okay, I'm going to move now to something different, as I said. So this was about the Green's function. We have kinetic Monte Carlo model, and we want to push this further. Again, this is something that we want to develop because you know a lot about neuromorphic computing and computing that try to kind of replicate our brain activities. And the way how the people do this is to use resistive memories. And the best way to simulate resistive memory is to use kinetic Monte Carlo. Kinetic Monte Carlo allows you to follow the trajectory from a probabilistic behavior of ions generation and traps and electrons generation and this oxide. So what you have here, a very simple device. You have a metal, you have oxide, and you have a metal. So oxide, metal, metal. And we can run simulations, and this is kind of a toy example at the moment, to see if NESS can behave well. And what you can see, you can have a form of filament, you can set the device and you can reset the device. And if you can think, you can think this your zero and this your one state, and you can change the zero and or zero state a couple of times, and you'll have a different values. What we are trying to do is to make NESS work better and have different kind of methods inside implemented. And this is our initial simulations. What we have here is the both are ion traps or ion vacancies generating in the oxide. And we know from the experiment that this device is on when you have a filament, you have a bridge connection between this electrode and this electrode, and this filament usually have a conic shape. And this is what we are looking at the moment. So you can see that increasing the voltage of the drain kind of starts creating this conical shape of the device. And we create the filament, and this is linked to the temperature also, you can understand. So we have spots of temperature here with around 300 Kelvin. the highest the temperature increases in this when you start creating the filament to around 318 Kelvin, and when the filament is created, you have a temperature around 500 Kelvin. So there is a huge heat generation where the filament, and this is how you can find the filament if you want, and you can link to the experiment. The other thing that's again linked to kinetic Monte Carlo is the simulating of flash memories. And in this case, we simulated molecular flash memory. We had a couple of papers, including a Nature paper linked to this. And now we got a project for $1.5 million that is starting this month for the next 3-4 years to work on these flash memories. And people find it very interesting because you can create multi-bit flash cell. So what you have here in the floating gate, you have molecules that each molecule can host up to 2 or 3 charges, not only one. And what you can do, you can start pumping charges and these molecules, and you can create 0, 1, 2, or 3, or 4 bit on the same flash cell. So you can have much more compressed data. And we started again simulating this structure with NESS. And what you see here is that you have 19 or 18 devices or 18 traps here, because you have 9 centers, 9 molecules. Each of them can host up to 2 electrons. And what you can see here, you can start populating each of these centers with electrons, and the voltage threshold moves to higher values. And Razaini knows this very well because his PhD was very similar. So this proves that NESS works. So when I'm putting traps inside of the floating gate, I move to higher voltage thresholds. Now, NESS also works in this kinetic Monte Carlo. It's important to be linked to Poisson, because if it doesn't, it's not linked to a Poisson equation, you can get different results, which are not correct 100%. So what you have here is a voltage threshold versus time, and this is so-called retention time. How long this flash cell will hold the information? And this is important because when you have flash cell here and you have a picture, you don't want this picture to disappear in 3 days. You want to stay probably 15 years until you decide to erase it. So what you have here, all of these pumps or molecules or traps are full with electrons, 2 of them, and you start to discharge them. And if this is not linked to self-consistent Poisson equation, the discharging is happening quite fast, and you have fully discharged cell on 10 to the minus 10 seconds. So this is, let's say, 1 state, this is 0 state. However, the most correct, or probably more correct one, is when you have self-consistent simulations and you have discharge of the molecules. First, up to here are discharged all of the 9 molecules by 1 electron. After this, you slowly start to discharge again each other molecule with one more electron, and this continues up to 10 to the 16 seconds. So now you have retention time, which is much, much longer, just coming from the fact that your simulations are linked to Poisson. And what you see here, actually, these symbols and red line corresponds to the mean of many simulations, I think 15 simulations. And the reason for this is you have, every time when you run kinetic Monte Carlo, because it's a stochastic process, you're going to have slightly different simulations. So every time when you run kinetic Monte Carlo, you have a probability of electron going from here to here, from here to here, from here to here. After this, you close the simulation, you start again, you run another random generator, and you have a different device or different behavior. You have electrons first moving from here, and from here, for example. And this is the reason that you have 4 or 5 green lines and blue lines here. And if you take further, what we can show is that this is a parameter in the oxide. The oxide, you know, it's amorphous material, and it's not always identical. So what we show in this simulation part here is that we need to be sure that the oxide is proper quality, because the multi-bit storage cell is this part. So you can have zero, something between 0 and 1, and 1, or the other way around. Depends how you set it up, and you need to be sure that you have a good quality oxide in order to have this multi-bit storage for this specific molecule and doesn't disappear. Okay, I'm going to finish here. I hope I showed you that NESS is a TCAD simulator that we really want to take it further. It has a structure generation, it has different modules from classical to quantum, can simulate novel electronic devices. This is only some of the things that I showed you. It can do much more. We hope that can be easily integrated, and we're open for collaboration, as I said, and we hopefully will publish as open source next year at some point. And there are some reference papers here. if you want to go and look more, you'll be more than welcome. Or if you want to contact me directly, this is my email or my Twitter or my account, and I'll be more than happy to answer your questions. So thank you very much for your time. Razed, if you're talking, I cannot hear you.
Okay. Apologize. Okay,
no,
thank you, Vihar. Thank you, Vihar, for your nice presentation. Okay, now we go to the Q&A session. In the chat box, the question from Balbu Kumar Ghosh. So, thank you for your presentation. Drain-induced barrier widening in TFAT is now a new approach to exhibit a steep sub-threshold swing, approximately 35 millivolt per decade, and a low of state current, which around 10 to 16 ampere per micrometer for 10 nanometer channel. Is this contact the device you have explained, and how extend this novel? How to extend? Yeah, that's the question.
Let me try to find the question, because I didn't understand exactly. Right. Sorry.
The novelty for the device.
So the novelty of this TFAT that we had is basically, at the moment, we just wanted to see if NESS can do it and if NESS can simulate it. So in this specific example is example to show the capability of NESS, and if it's needed, we can modify the structure and simulate the device that is mentioned here. I'm not claiming that this is the device that we are going to fabricate or someone is going to make it. It's just an example of what NESS can do.
Okay.
Babu, is this correct? I mean, did I answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. And you're asking, is this from 2D simulations? I guess for you're talking about the TFAT again. No, it's 3D, so it's all, everything is in 3D.
Okay, and then question from Dr. Sharifa. Is NESS an open source or licensed software for research use, and how we public can access the tools?
Yeah, so this is the ultimate goal, to make it open access, and maybe Razed, you know, or maybe not, we have another company here.
Oh.
Which is called Semiwise, and so we use NESS to do some commercial work as well for clients of this company. So now we're looking what kind of licenses we really need in order to have academic version and business version. So our ultimate goal, my aim, is to be open source license for everyone. Basically, everyone can use it, but we're still in the process of polishing the code and also talking to the people what license we need to use and how. So the main problem at the moment actually is the kind of the license issue.
Okay.
So, but we want to make it open source. Hopefully it will happen next year. I really hope, because we kind of more or less know where we to look now.
Okay. Yeah, it's great. So at least here from Malaysia, we can use the software and then try to follow your step, actually. Yes.
I mean, if you remember Zhe, for example, in China, we work with her and we give her the code, but not the source code. We give her the executable, and she can still run some simulations with her students for flash memories, for example. This is what we did in the past. Mm-hmm. So even if still not open source as a code, we still can cooperate in principle.
Okay, nice. Okay.
So flexible FAT, I don't know what you mean by flexible FAT.
Flexible transistors. Have you tried modeling it?
Yes, but they made from what material? What kind of flexible?
Well, the easiest, I guess.
Well, I have a colleague who makes a flexible FETs from silicon.
Yes, silicon. Yeah, that would be easiest. Yeah, the basic. Have you tried modeling it?
Well, depends what you want to do exactly. The flexible FinFET transistors that he makes are microns, and they're, or in the best case, 500 nanometers. And we have not tried this yet, but I'm sure that we can model it this, because it's you can use drift diffusion for do this, and you don't need any kind of fancy quantum mechanical methods or anything quantum taking into account, because the device is relatively big. So if you have silicon and you want to model, let's say, 500 micron device or 1 micron device, you can do it with NESS. We never tried it, but I'm pretty much sure it will work with drift diffusion. And you can try it with all of the other modules if you want to see, but drift diffusion will work well. If you want to simulate 2D devices like MOS2 or, I don't know, some kind of more graphene or carbon nanotube, it's not going to work yet, because you need to change significantly the physics inside of the modules. So you can do it in principle if you know how to modify the code and the right physics and the right equations. This is the whole aim. We have the Poisson equation, which is solves in 3D the charge distribution and gives you potential. And if you know what equation you need to use the current, you can implement it and you can link it to our Poisson equation and can give you back what you're asking for.
Okay, well, it goes to my second question. So if a flexible transistor would take into account of stress, stress parameters, right? Some bending. Yes. So how do you integrate that in your current model of the Poisson? Do you change this, the current models?
We don't take into account stress in any way, but usually what's happening is when you take into account, you need to change the band structure a bit. So what is happening, the band structure is changing slightly when you have the stress, and this you need to take into account somehow and to modify it. But again, we don't have this capability. Someone needs to sit and implement it.
I see. Okay. I have another question, actually. If say we have a Verilog HSPICE netlist, is it possible to integrate it, to compile it on NESS and try to get the performance? Is it possible? Because I don't know how NESS works. Is it NESS works like Silvaco? You build it from scratch and then you run it, or is it like we can upload a like a Verilog HSPICE netlist and then we can run it on NESS and get the...
No. So it's not the SPICE. It's like most probably like the first version. So it's a device simulator. It's a not process simulator. It's not compact model simulator. It's a device simulator.
I see.
So okay. You can simulate the device. You can instruct the resistance and capacitance if you want. And you can put this in the netlist or in the compact model. But it's not compact model simulator.
I see. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Vihar. I think that's another question there.
What was it? Yeah, okay. So from Mir Mat Fahimul Islam, can we simulate 2D material-based FET in NESS environment?
The short answer in the current state, no. But if you have time and you know how to implement it, there should be this is what we created, that you can create a module, which is, let's say, called 2D material MOSFET. You implement the equation. You plug this module in the NESS and you use again the same Poisson solver. You can use the same database, the same structure generator. You're just calling this module of 2D material model and it should work, but it's not done yet. Someone, if you have a PhD student or someone wants to come and do it, I'll be more than happy. Just don't have time for this at the moment.
Okay. So any question from the floor?
Sorry, I have one more last question. Right. I think the current thing now is the synaptic transistor, right? The synaptic transistor. So so synaptic transistor takes into account the charging and discharging of the traps. So do you use that in NESS? Can it be modeled in NESS?
So if you're talking about synaptic transistors in terms of resistive memory, is this what you're talking about?
Yeah, sure. It's more or less the same, similar.
So this kinetic Monte Carlo that you see here, I hope you see my slide. Yes, can you see the slide? So yes. What you have here, or maybe I can bring you. So we are developing this kinetic. Can you see the slide?
Yes.
Okay, so-called for you synaptic resistor, which probably is the resistive memory, what you have is when you apply voltage in this oxide, you need to create a filament, you create a soft breakdown, right? This is what you do. And this creating soft breakdown is usually associated with move of ions. Depends what material you have. If you have a silicon dioxide, let's say, as an insulator oxide, usually you move oxygen vacancies. So what you need to do, you need to follow the trajectory of these ions, which are the oxygen vacancies, together with the how the electrons were going to hop from this electrode to this electrode. And what we have here at the moment is what we are developing is this kinetic Monte Carlo that can follow the ions and the electrons. This is kind of the charge distribution. This can go to Poisson equation, and this is in the loop together. And you cannot heat equation in the top if you want, but let's forget about the heat. So what you see here, can you see this light here? These white balls here are the oxygen vacancies. So they're generated randomly using kinetic Monte Carlo through a random generator on this volume of the oxide. And as you can see, they start, when you start generating more and more in the same place, you create like a seed, and the kinetic Monte Carlo algorithm changes the probability that you will create a new vacancy closer to this seed. And what you can see, you create kind of this filament. And these people will see in the TEM images, they see this filament usually looks like a cone, and you can simulate this resistive memory. But there are 6-7 mechanisms that you need to follow. You can go in this paper maybe, or in this paper here, that they're very similar for simulating resistive memories and flash cell memories. The whole point is this is a bit easier because you don't need to follow the trajectory of the ions. This is a bit more complicated because you need to follow the trajectory of the ions and the generation and the recombination and the capture and emission time of the electrons. So in principle, yes, it's possible. And this is what we are working at the moment to try to make it work better.
Thank you, Dr. Vihar. Yes. Thank you.
No problem.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Sharifa. So any question from the floor? Vihar, this one is from Taufik, right?
Yes.
Okay.
So he is in Finland now at the moment, if you know, but we still work from time to time. Because he started this kinetic Monte Carlo and the other guys came here and we started implementing it and make it even better.
Okay, nice.
And this one is from August. I don't know, you didn't meet him. I think you were gone by, but so he started implementing this in the resistive, on the flash memory side.
Okay.
This is slightly easier than the previous one, but there is a guy called Daniel at the moment here who is working. So these two guys, Daniel and Yasin, are working on kinetic Monte Carlo at the moment to implement all of the modules that we need, or all the physics that we need inside.
Okay.
Hi, Viha. Sorry, Dr. Razaidi, I have one question.
Yeah,
sure.
Please proceed.
Okay, yeah. Viha, just to let everybody know about the opportunities in pursuing PhD or master, right, in this scope. Right, device modeling in Glasgow. Yes. Can you, maybe you can brief a little bit on the extension of this version or this modeling, right?
Yes. So maybe Razaidi is the best person to know how to all of the administrative stuff, how you come and become a student in Glasgow University from Malaysia, because I don't know, but Razaidi definitely knows. What I can say is that I have students working. So I have European project that I have students working on material grow in 3.5s, and they work with IBM and Synopsys in Denmark. I have students that were trying to look in Josephson junction. I didn't talk about this in the moment, but we're trying to make NESS to work with Josephson junction, which is very early stage. I have student that is going to start working now on this molecular flash memories because we got a huge project doing this. And if a student come here, I would like to take this job further. For example, resistive memories, this is what we discuss, because we are still developing at the moment and we can make it work better. So there is opportunities, let's say molecular flash memories, maybe qubits, silicon spin qubits, because this is what I want to do with NESS, and we probably can do it. Josephson junction, this is what we're working. Molecular electronics, in a sense, I have another student with a chemistry that simulates these pond molecules as from chemistry perspective, and resistive RAM memories. This is another thing that we can look into.
Yep.
So kind of, and the other thing that we're really pushing with the company actually is cryo-CMOS. This also working very hard on this because the models, especially in drift diffusion models, they're not good for cryo-electronics. And we want to NESS to be able to simulate cryo-CMOS devices. So all of these simulations that I showed you, it takes into account default room temperature.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, very interesting. There are so many topics to explore, right? So I hope it's not only for a master or PhD studies, but it's also for like the research leave or for the postdoc, right?
Yes.
Very interesting, and actually this is very important for the I believe for the semiconductor modeling industries, right?
Yeah, so what is our perspective? I mean, there's our group, Razaidi knows this and he knows a lot of people. A lot of the people that they work in the group went to work in Synopsys in here in UK, in Glasgow. Mm-hmm. And there are at least 20 people from ASENS as postdocs and PhD students, Razaidi knows some of them, working there. And they're constantly hiring people, constantly. So these three or four guys that I showed you, they went to work for Synopsys as well. So this guy started with us and work with Synopsys. These other two guys didn't want to work with Synopsys. They went to work somewhere else. So our group seems to be kind of successful to put people in the right place to work in TCAD. So Hamil Salim went to work in Intel, which I think is quite good, and Hamilton to simulate on again. So from educational point of view, it's something nice that we can do as well. I mean, educate people and
Make the connections. Thank you. I believe that maybe after the post-pandemic era, right? So we might have opportunities to travel and even for our universities, right? Lecturers, researchers, right? They might have opportunity to travel for the attachment, right? So I believe that this is the very good scope to support the semiconductor industries. Right, to explore. Maybe we are not very actively involved in semiconductor modeling in Malaysia, right? So so that I believe that this is something we can make this such as a niche area, right, in semiconductor research.
I'll be more than happy to help you. I really want to make the code really open source, hopefully in the next 3-4 months after New Year. And we can start this collaboration even further.
Okay, thank you, Vihar.
No problem, pleasure. So Mir has another question. So this is, everything is on Linux base, but and it's C++, it's compiled on Linux, and it uses
Hello, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Yes. Yeah, Mama, please go ahead. Yeah.
Okay, all right. Have you done any match between the simulation and measured data, and how close is it between the simulation and the measured data using this software?
We did for some drift diffusion nanowires in the beginning when we started with the Green's function also. So as I said, we work on European project. I don't have this data here, but when we started, we worked on three European projects, and we needed, there was a nanowire fabrication in Leti in France. They measured the device, and we needed to match their fabrication. So first we calibrated this with drift diffusion, and after this we calibrated with the Green's function. So we did this in the past, but I don't have here this as a data. So we did it only for the nanowire, silicon nanowires at the moment. We have not done it for any other devices at the moment, per se. We did for a bit for the kinetic Monte Carlo. There was a calibration in this paper. If you go here in this paper, you will see there is a calibration between the kinetic Monte Carlo and some literature data.
All right. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Mama. So any question from the floor? We have another 4 minutes. Any question? So you can reach Vihar by his email, vihar.georgiev@glasgow.ac.uk. Yeah, if you have
any. Or you can follow me on Twitter or LinkedIn or anything else, and you can just send me message there if you want. It's up to you.
Yeah, actually, I'm thinking of the tools. So let's say if it is available to for us to be used, so I mean we can start do collaboration, something like that.
Yeah, we can do this. We're really at the moment just really trying to sort out the code and polish it and make it work and kind of consistent. So, but if you want, we can share with you just the executable orders idea at the moment, like we did with Z, and just run the code. You cannot implement anything, but you can still kind of run and get the feeling about it, how it works.
Hi, Dr. Vihar, can I ask one question?
Sure, of course.
Yeah, instead of the silicon nanowire, we can use the silver nanowire and simulate?
Silver nanowire for, is this a transistor again, or what you want to simulate?
No, it's a conductive material, like for the electrodes.
Well, so all of the things that I describe here are based either for semiconductor material or insulator. In principle, you can simulate if you change the right physics. I mean, you need to change the models inside of the code to capture the right transport and the right mechanisms. So as how it's designed at the moment, no, because it's a metal, basically. You know, silver is metal and it's going to be a wire, literally. So it's not a semiconductor, right?
Yes, it's not semiconductor, right?
So at the moment, NESS cannot simulate because it was designed to simulate transistors which have semiconductor materials.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Welcome.
Okay, last question for Dr. Vihar.
Hello, Dr. Vihar.
Hello.
I would like to ask for the NESS. It's only available in the Linux environment, not in Windows.
No. Yeah. So it can work in Windows as well. We just need to compile the code. So if you have a Windows compile on C++ with the libraries, they should no reason not to work in Windows. Usually, what we have is we ship this in Docker, which is what we did with some colleagues in India. Do you know what is Docker?
No.
Okay, so do you know what's a virtual machine?
Oh, yes.
Okay, so Docker is a virtual machine without the operational system. So basically, it creates a container, and in this container, it has all of the environment. This code needs to run. And our Docker usually have a lighter version of Linux that we kind of use the Linux environment in this as a virtual environment, and you can open and run it on Windows or anything else, Mac or whatever you want. So this one way of doing it, and this kind of we shipped it to our friends in this way.
I see. So for the Linux, we can use the CentOS or the free.
We use CentOS 6 and CentOS 7. Now we move to CentOS 7.
Okay.
And we need some. We're using some WAPAC and ScalaPAC libraries and some Boost libraries that need to be also in the pathway in the operational system.
So if we were to use the, for example, Ubuntu, then we need to install another additional library for this NESS to fully function?
Yes.
Right. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mama Afis. Okay, now we move to the next agenda, which is to present your cert.
Okay. So let me stop sharing this.
Okay.
Yeah, we are going to present your certificate, Vihar.
Thank you very much. I'm really touched. Thank you. So, here is the idea. I'll wait for you to come and bring it to me.
Sure.
Thank you. Oh, it looks amazing. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Sorry, Dr. Zaidi, there's another improvised version. Sorry.
Oh, this is not the latest version. Vihar, we co-organized this session with IEEE Electron Devices Society, Malaysia section. I'm the past chair. Maybe I was the chair when I was visiting you.
Okay, I remember. Right?
You got my CPE souvenir, right?
Yeah. So, it's here. Yes.
Yeah, if I could have opportunity next year or the following year, right? So I should bring the original copy of your certificate. This is the certificate. Thank you very much. Thank you for your precious time spending on the talk. Very informative and give some insights for the device modeling. I believe that some of them coming from, I've seen from the list, some of them were from semiconductor industries doing the power semiconductor.
Okay, yes.
So
this is something very
We're
also interesting, but just not enough time at the moment to do everything.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I hope with this at least they can get some inputs to pursue with master studies or PhD studies. Okay, thank you, Vihar. Maybe after this we can have a photo session.
Yes, sure. No problem. Thank you very much. Pleasure. It was great. Thank you, guys. And for everyone else who helped organize this seminar, I think it was a lot of work. So thank you for everyone else, not only Razaidi, but who else was involved.
Yeah. So everybody can switch on your camera so that we can take photo with Dr. Vihar.
Yes. Maybe Razaidi, you can stop sharing. Maybe.
We have two versions with the. With the cert.
You know how to do it. I don't know. Yes. Okay.
Hafiz, is it okay now? Have you captured?
Hold on.
Okay. Now I share this one. Okay.
All right.
Nice to see you guys. Now it's much better when I see faces.
Sorry, my camera is not working.
It's okay.
Okay. Oh, hold on. Okay, done. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. for your presentation.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Vihar, any plan? Do you have any plan to come to Malaysia?
I really want to come, but now with this COVID, the situation is, you know, it's very crazy. But I'm very open, and as I said, I'm very happy.
Let me know. Last time you come to Singapore, right?
Yes, I was in Singapore. Yes, but this is many years ago. Next time, yeah.
Yeah, don't worry. We'll invite Vihar to be the speaker of our conference. We have many upcoming IEEE conference, Vihar.
Okay.
So we have to make sure this is the physical conference. Then you can travel to Malaysia, not the virtual one, right? Okay. So are you ready for the photo session? Sorry, I have to change my device just now.
Okay.
Razaidi, can we?
Okay,
we can take photo.
All right.
Okay,
Hafiz, are you taking the photo?
All right. 1, 2, 3. Okay,
thank you. Sorry, I have to change my device just now.
Okay, no problem.
Thank you. Thank you for all participants.
Yes, thank you guys. It was a pleasure for me as well.
Yeah. So actually, Dr. Vihar and Prof. Ashen Ashenov had, I think, how many Malaysian PhD students in from Malaysia, right?
Yeah, I don't know. I know only Razaidi, but I'm sure they were before. They were some other people.
So really, I believe that this group is really visible for the device modeling, right? I always share to everybody that we had the contact with the, the Sifu of the device modeling.
Yes, you're always welcome here, definitely.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Vihar. So, Dr. Razaidi?
Okay, I'm good. Yeah, no worries. I will always contact with her from time to time.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you to all participants for joining us. Okay, bye.
Stay safe.
Okay, bye. Thank you, Dr. Razaidi. Okay, bye,
Thank you all
for organizing the.